Much of my work is very inspired by the seasons. The whole title, Spring Pheasant, is really important, and it's really echoed within the piece itself. You know, I can tell it as a botanist that it's sort of early April by the signs of the stitchwort and the dog violet being in flower, and the wood anemones along the bottom. Yet, if I was a naturalist or someone who knew their game birds really well, I'd take one look at the cock pheasant and see the fact that he has these lovely feathery ears behind his head, and the fact that his red wattle is so engorged with blood. I can tell that it's spring. You know, this is when he's trying to look his best for the female pheasants. I'd been looking out for a long time to do a painting involving the melanistic variety, which look absolutely beautiful with the full sunlight on them. They look like some beautiful, rare piece of old bottle or glass or something, you know, something really antique and special. One element I particularly like is the plant in the background, which is a plant called cuckoo pint, or lords and ladies, and it's a plant that first appears in early spring. And it comes into flower when the first cuckoos begin to arrive in sort of April or May. The unfurled yellowy spikes of the flower that first appear, they push up through the leaf litter, and that goes on and follows to the flower where it's actually open. You've got this wonderful trumpet with this strange tongue. Small details like that I find really quite exciting. They're often missed by people when they look at the painting, but as a keen naturalist, I know they're there and take a great deal of pleasure from the subtle narratives that go on around the actual main subject matter of the, in this case, the pheasants themselves. This book's all Victorian art. All the masters are in here, the ones that I really find inspiring. This is one of my favourite paintings. John Everett Millais is a particularly favourite artist. If you took away the actual subject of Ophelia, you're left with an absolutely fantastic painting of a stream. Perhaps we share some of the same passions for the natural history details. So I've got a male grouse here calling. It's late evening, the sun's just about to set, and it really is the last shreds of the day. And they're quite small birds. I mean, they're literally, I don't know, 10 to 12 inches high, but they've got such a large character. The males are incredibly cocky and can be quite aggressive, you know, in spring. I've deliberately shown the grouse with its beak open. And again, they have this absolutely fantastic call. It's kind of a call that fits the type of landscape, a bit like the sound of the wind going through rocks and heather. You know, the sound of a distant grouse sort of proclaiming its territory is very evocative. In terms of natural history spectacles, I can honestly say that watching black grouse perform at the Leck in Cumbria, you know, as dawn's breaking over this very wild, remote area, is the most exciting thing I've ever seen. Very inspiring. I've tried to just show the extravagant, arrogant display of a black grouse, where the tail feathers are all erect. And the wings are sort of drooping down, so they scratch and scrape across the grass. And I've tried to show drops of water hanging on the tussock grass either side of him to suggest that a passing rain shower has just finished. very appropriate for the habitat of the black grouse, where you get sunshine one second and rain the next. They're really hardy birds, really special too. I've tried to hopefully show a sort of a calm family group here, where the male partridge has got this most incredible call, and it really carries across distance. And I think it's a bit like the song of a skylark. It's one of those calls that I really associate with deep countryside that's still very traditional in the way it's farmed. And I've tried to show the male grey partridge here, which I've deliberately placed against a slightly uncluttered backdrop where there's no strong backlit plants, just so he really stands out. But this really is supposed to be rather a timeless painting, you know, where partridge, the English partridge, is common once again. But I've taken a lot of pleasure out of not only painting the partridge, but painting all the weeds. This is one of my favourite weeds, actually, plantain. They've just got this great crinkly leaf, and being a nice wide leaf and quite a tall plant, you do get some lovely light through it. So maybe I'm the artist who paints weeds, and you know, it's as important as the subject matter itself.